Well, good evening. It's good to see everybody. Because you know, you can't really see people if on the other side of a stream. So it's good to see people here. Lord, we thank you for being able to gather together. Lord, we thank you that you are so good, that your mercy endures forever, Lord. We pray that you would be blessed and honored as we worship you. Lord, as we devote this time to you, have your way. We pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen. So, I'm going to change a battery because it just died. So now would be a good time that if you have your cell phone to pull it out and share. That's kind of weird because everything just went away from my ears too. So it's really simple. You grab your cell phone, you pull up Facebook, and you share Calvary Chapel Susanville just to get God's word out there. Because we have to do our part. Batteries go out at always the wrong time. Okay. Hey, I can hear stuff. God is good. Lord, thank you again for tonight. Bless this time. In Jesus' name, amen. If you're able, let's go ahead and stand for this first song.
Christ is my reward and all of my devotion. Now there's nothing in this world satisfied.
Let's sing that again. Christ is my reward.
Christ is my reward in all of my devotion. Now there's nothing in this world that can ever satisfy. Through every trial, my soul will sing. No. Turning back, I have decided to follow.
Oh, gracious Father, we thank you. Those words are so true. You are everything we need. And we love you so much, Lord, but we thank you for loving us first and loving us most. And guide us, Lord, tonight. Help us to hear your voice more clearly. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen and amen. Well, welcome in Jesus' name, you guys. You can be seated. Welcome everybody listening on the radio and on Facebook and all that. A couple quick announcements. At the end of this month, on May 30th, we've got our FMO, four-men-only breakfast. And guys, I encourage you to sign up for that. Come out. It's going to be a great time together, and it always is. And then Family Camp is still on. That's June 11th through the 16th. And that's going to be out at Eagle Lake as scheduled. Checked with them just a couple days ago, and they're saying they're going to be open in time. They're getting geared up with all the stuff and everything. And so we're still going to the coast. It's just the coast of the lake. And so, you know, that'll work out pretty cool. But anyway, and then I mentioned about the one-day marriage conference on June 27th. I confirmed with the folks at the Calvary Reno Sparks, and so we're going to be having that here. And we're going to probably have it in the backyard here at church. And it's kind of cool. I'm excited about it because we've got, besides myself, we're going to have Pastor Tony LeBay teaching a session, Pastor Terry Johnson teaching a session. And I'm waiting for confirmation, but I think we're going to have Pastor Andrew Morales from Reno Sparks teaching a session as well. And so we're going to have a barbecue lunch in between, and it's going to be a great time. And so looking forward to that very, very much. And then that's it. Thank you, Father, so much for your love and kindness and your faithfulness. Help us this night, Lord, to worship you. In Jesus' name, amen. Let's continue to worship.
You.
Pray that those words would be true, that you would be all our heart is living for. Lord, you would be every desire. Jesus, that you would fill every breath. You would fill every thought. God, I pray that every heart here tonight would be surrendered to you. We put it at your feet. God, we pray less of us, less of me, Lord, and more of you.
Yeah.
Gracious Father, as we sing these words tonight about surrendering to you and giving you our life, that's our desire, Lord. That's what's in our heart. But Lord, we fight the flesh, and we need you to make that true in us, Lord. So we're willing, but Lord, would you do the work? Would you do that good thing in us? Guide us, Lord, to surrender to you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen and amen. Well, God bless you guys. Welcome in Jesus' name. Why don't you turn and say hello to somebody. Hi, Ed. Hey, Luke. Hey, Bob.
Watch out. Hi.
Hey, how you doing?
Oh, you don't have to flip it.
You sure?
Pretty good, yeah.
Yeah, okay.
Yeah, thank you, though.
Okay.
Huh?
Well, all I can say is that it's good to be in the house of the Lord, and it's good to be together as a family, and man, no better place to be than in front of God's Word and together and just seeking His face, and so here we are. Tonight, we're going to be in 1 Timothy chapter 6 as we continue in our trek through the Bible, and I'm hoping to get it done in a reasonable amount of time. It's one of those you could almost split it up, but then it'd be like too short and like too long, who knows, but y'all already know, but anyway, let's read the chapter together, and then we'll go back and we'll study it through. And so once you get your Bibles open to 1 Timothy chapter 6, once they're open, if you will, if you're able, let's stand together in reverence for God's Word as we read it together. 1 Timothy chapter 6, beginning at verse 1, it says, "Let as many bondservants as are under the yoke count their own masters worthy of all honor, so that the name of God and his doctrine may not be blasphemed. And those who are believing masters, let them not despise them, or those who have believing masters, let them not despise them because they are brethren, but rather serve them because those who are benefited are believers and beloved. Teach and exhort these things. And if anyone teaches otherwise and does not consent to wholesome words, even the words of our Lord Jesus Christ, and to the doctrine which accords with godliness, he is proud, knowing nothing, but is obsessed with disputes and arguments over words, from which some even strife, or from which some envy, strife, reviling, evil suspicions, useless wranglings of men, corrupt minds, and destitute of the truth, who suppose that godliness is a means of gain. From such, withdraw yourself. Now, godliness with contentment is great gain, for we brought nothing into this world, and it's certain we can carry nothing out. And having food and clothing, with all these we shall be content. But those who desire to be rich fall into temptation and a snare, and into many foolish and harmful lusts, which drown men in destruction and perdition. For the love of money is the root of all kinds of evil, which some have strayed from the faith in their greediness and pierced themselves through with many sorrows. But you, O man of God, flee these things and pursue righteousness, godliness, faith, love, patience, gentleness. Fight the good fight of faith. Lay hold on eternal life, to which you were also called and have confessed the good confession in the presence of many witnesses. I urge you in the sight of God, who gives life to all things, and before Christ Jesus, who witnessed the good confession before Pontius Pilate, that you keep this commandment without spot, blameless until our Lord Jesus Christ's appearing, which he will manifest in his own time. He was blessed, who is the blessed and only potentate, the King of kings and Lord of lords, who alone has immortality, dwelling in an unapproachable light, whom no man has seen or can see, to whom be honor and everlasting power. Amen. Command those who are rich in this present age not to be haughty, nor to trust in uncertain riches, but in the living God who gives us richly all things to enjoy. Let them do good, that they be rich in good works, ready to give, willing to share, storing up for themselves a good foundation for the time to come, that they may lay hold on eternal life. O Timothy, guard what is committed to your trust. Avoid the profane and idle babblings and contradictions of what is falsely called knowledge. By professing it, some have strayed concerning the faith. Grace be with you. Amen. Gracious Father, we thank you for this word of encouragement, exhortation, instruction. It's so much, Lord. And we thank you for your grace and your kindness. And we thank you for your faithfulness, Lord, to teach your children. And we stand here tonight, Lord, needy of your instruction. And so would you guide us, Lord? Would you help us to hear your voice? In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. And amen. You can be seated. Well, as Paul continues in his instruction of Timothy, it's a combination of instruction and encouragement. You know, you kind of see him getting fired up there towards the end where he starts worshiping God and stuff, you know, gets lost in what he's doing. But, you know, Timothy needs the instruction, and we do as well. And he starts off here in verse 1. He says, "Let as many bondservants as are under the yoke count their own masters worthy of all honor, so that the name of God and his doctrine may not be blasphemed." But the first word there, first key word, I should say, let as many bondservants, the word bondservants, we're familiar with that. It's the word doulos in the Greek, and it refers to a slave or a servant, but someone who is voluntarily or willingly a slave. And as you go through the Bible, actually, the same word is actually used for servants as well, not necessarily voluntary servants, but it's used in both applications. But here, Paul is using it referring to the servants of Jesus Christ, not just earthly slaves as such. And he makes a distinction, as many as under the yoke, referring, if you will, to regular servants or slaves, understanding that at that time, as Paul is writing this, the Roman Empire pretty much ruled the world. They were the dominant power. And two-thirds of the people on the planet, at least under Roman control, were slaves. And so it's something that's really foreign to us. We think of slavery, we think back to our own national history, back to the slave days in the South and all that kind of stuff, when the African-Americans now were brought in as slaves and used as property. And that's our perspective on slavery. You know, we've learned history about that. But back in the day, man, every color, every stripe, every kind of person, you know, if you were conquered, you were taken as a slave. If you grew up in a poor family and dad needed, you know, couldn't feed you anymore, oftentimes he would sell you into slavery, you know, different things like that. And so that was really much more common then than we can imagine. And so, again, some were born into it, some were captured in wars, some through poverty were sold into bondage. Some may have started out in adverse circumstances, yet when they had the opportunity to gain their freedom, many of them remained with their masters because they realized that the life that they had, even in servitude, even in slavery, and it wasn't like everybody was, you know, beat with whips all day long. I mean, many of those servants were household servants. They cleaned the house, they cooked, they tended to the sheep and the kids, all kinds of stuff. And they were very much like family members. And so when they had a good life and they realized how good they had it, many of them, you know, when they were given the opportunity for freedom, said, you know, I want to stay here. I've got a better life with you. And so they would become willing slaves, willing bondservants. In fact, they would even go through, you know, and slaves were marked in different ways. Some were tattooed, some were branded, some wore like a heavy metal neck neck ring kind of a thing, or even an ankle ring where they could secure them, you know, keep them from running away, that kind of stuff. But those that were voluntary slaves, bondservants, if you will, they would go through this thing where they would stand by the doorpost of the house. The master of the house would pierce their ear through with an awl to the doorpost. And then that's their connection to the house now. And then they would give them an earring, and that symbolized the fact that they were voluntary slaves. They didn't have to get beaten. They didn't have to get dragged around or forced. They wanted to be there. And that's why we're called bondservants of Christ, because no one, I hope, has put a gun to you and said, confess Christ or else. You know, when we came to Jesus Christ, we came humbly. We came, I want to be with you. I want to be in your presence, you know, and I want to live my life for you. And so we've become bondservants of Christ. And there were many people that were voluntarily bondservants of Christ, yet still under the quote-unquote yoke of bondage, where they weren't their own. And so when Paul used that language about we're bought with a price, you know, we're not our own, they understood that. You know, it played to them a little bit. And so here he's drawing that distinction. The modern-day application for most of us would be as employees or hired servants, if you will. I mean, I used to tell people all the time at the PD, you know, guys would complain, you know, the guys would just, you know, snivel and whine about, you know, how bad it is and how horrible it is. You don't have to be a cop. I mean, it's so bad, quit. It's so bad, go somewhere else. You know, stop complaining. You know, and because there's people that would die for your job. And so I think the modern day equivalent, the application for us is workers and our bosses. And in that application, and in what Paul's exhorting the bondservants then, these men and women that were under, if you will, the yoke of bondage was, do the best job you can do. You know, be a good witness. Paul tells us in Philippians chapter 2, verse 14, he says, do all things without complaining or murmuring or disputing. You know, be a good witness. You're going to witness to your employer, to your co-workers, to those around you, and so do a good job. He tells the Colossians in Colossians 3:23, and whatever you do, do it heartily as to the Lord and not to men. You know, when I'm out, and not just because I'm a pastor, but, you know, when I'm working on the church or I'm doing stuff around the church or my house, even in different places, I don't think, I'm not grumbling because my wife's making me do something or because, you know, I've got to fix something. I'm thinking, I'm serving God. God lets me come to his house and do stuff. You know, God lets me go to other people's houses and touch his house, his people. And when we come to that realization, man, it is a joy to serve God. And it should be. In whatever capacity. You know, if you're a plumber, a candlestick maker, or, you know, whatever, do it as unto the Lord. And let your light shine in your countenance, in the way that you talk to people, all those things, because it's a witness. You know, believers should be the best workers. Believers should be the most diligent. Believers should, you know, respect our employers and our supervisors and seeking to be the best witness that we can be. The favorite people I got to lead to the Lord when I was at the police department was my lieutenants and my commander and people that I got to witness to that were above me. I mean, I got to witness and say, you know, to lead a lot of cops to the Lord. I enjoyed that. But the guys that saw me in action, that knew maybe things about me that the subordinates didn't and different things like that, they knew that it was real because I was trying so hard to witness to them through my work ethic. And it's effective. It blows people away sometimes. Why are you such a good person? Why are you such a cheerful person? Why are you such, you know, and it's like, I'm not good. I'll tell you how bad I am, but I'm not good. The only thing good in me is Jesus. And so when you have a good work ethic and a good work performance, then you have that opportunity to do that with people. Pointedly, as Paul is making the point here, we don't want the name of our God to be dragged through the mud. We don't want his name blasphemed. And when you read that word blasphemed or blasphemy, it means that he would be wrongly spoke of, and it also mentions, or his doctrine. To blaspheme is to somehow communicate to people that God is not as good as he is. To speak wrongly about God, and it means to revile, to hurt, or to damage the reputation of, to speak evil of, to slander, or to malign. We need to be good ambassadors of Jesus Christ, a good representation of Jesus Christ. That's what Christians are. They were first called Christians in Antioch. Why? Because they were supposed to be, quote, unquote, Christ-like. And so we want to be that. Pointedly, though, to be a good witness to those around us. In Hebrews chapter 12, verse 1, therefore we also, since we're surrounded by so great a cloud of witnesses, let us lay aside every weight and the sin which so easily ensnares us, and let us run with endurance the race that is set before us. We are surrounded by witnesses. And, you know, people get, I don't like living in a glass bowl, in a glass house. I don't like the transparency, you know, and so we'll get used to it. Tough cookies is another way to put that, because people are going to be watching, and that's okay. You know what? Sometimes, I'll be honest with you, I'm so shallow. Sometimes when I know people are watching, that's when I act good. I don't want to do it just to please men, but there are times when you guys are around me, and that keeps me in control. That keeps me, like, you know, the lid on, all that kind of stuff, you know? And we need, that's part of why I like hanging out with you, because I act better when you're here. But the point is that we need to be good, because you never know who's watching or when. You know, and but he says there about doctrine. The name of God and his doctrine may not be blasphemed. So my question is, what doctrine? There's things we could point out leading up to this point in his letter, but I kind of reach back a little farther, and I think that his doctrine truly is the doctrine of love. You can boil it all down to the doctrine of love. Jesus told his disciples in John 13:35, a new commandment I give you, that you love one another as I have loved you, that you also love one another. If we walk in love, we're going to love God, we're going to honor him. If we walk in love, then we're going to love our neighbor, and we're going to be kind to them and honest and all those different kinds of things. All the commandments are going to end up being fulfilled in that, because our God is love. In 1 John chapter 4, verses 7 and 8, it says, beloved, let us love one another, for God is, for love is of God. And everyone who loves is born of God and knows God. He who does not love does not know God, for God is love. That's the hallmark of a real Christian, that they're loving and kind. You know, sad to say, but, you know, a lot of people claim to be Christians. I mean, the Mormons claim to be Christians, and different groups that are out there that aren't, you know, claim to be Christians. And you know, and some of them, you see them, so, you know, you watch people live, and you can say, wow, that they really love Jesus because they really love. But you see other people that are just, I hate to say it, but they're jerks. You know, they're mean-spirited or different things, you know, and you kind of see some of that stuff, and you kind of go, I'm not sure what kind of Christian they are, you know, but not the real kind, I don't think. But, you know, in 1 John chapter 4, verse 16, and we have known and believed the love that God has for us. God is love, and he who abides in love abides in God, and God in him. That's how you can tell that you're in that abiding relationship, you know, that his love is kind of, you know, coming out. And all of this, by the way, you know, it'd be neat if we could just conjure it up and just do it. I mean, before I was saved, I tried to be nice. Before I was saved, I tried to be honest. All those different kinds of things. I turned over a new leaf so many times, I was, you know, like in one of those salad rotator things. But what we're talking about is a work of the Spirit in each of our hearts and lives. And that's why we have to walk in the Spirit. That's why we have to be repentant and humble and ask the Holy Spirit, you know, Jesus to come in us. And then when he's in us, he begins to work from the inside out. And then the fruit of the Spirit becomes more and more manifest, we pray, you know, in our lives. And the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, long-suffering, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, self-control. Against such there is no law. Don't you want that coming out of your life? That's what I want coming out of my mouth and my heart and my mind. You know, I want the fruit of the Spirit to be evident. And then Paul describes, I won't read it all the way through, but in 1 Corinthians chapter 13, verses 4 through 8, he describes what love really looks like. The bottom line is that we want to be good witnesses and good ambassadors for Christ. I remember hearing at a crusade many years ago that there are people that have become Christians because they saw Christians. And there's people that won't become Christians because they saw Christians, so-called. You know, and we may be the only Bible that our neighbor, our co-workers, our boss ever see. There's a lot of people that will never come through these doors, you know, checking it out, or they're curious. But they'll watch your life. And so your life has to be consistent with God's word. Paul tells the Corinthians in 2 Corinthians chapter 3, verse 3, he said, for as much as you are an epistle of Christ, Christ's love letter, ministered by us, written not with ink, but by the Spirit of the living God, not on tablets of stone, but on tablets of flesh, that is, of the heart. And so I pray that we would give God, you know, wide margins, you know, plenty of space, and he could just write his word and write his own heart on our heart, overprint us, if you will, that we would simply reflect him to those around us. In verse 2, he says, and those who have believing masters, let them not despise them because they are brethren, but rather serve them because those who are benefited are believers and beloved. Teach and exhort these things. And so if you've got a believing boss, you know, a Christian boss, then don't despise them or take advantage of them because they're believers. You know, you're a believer, so, oh, I could take a little extra time on my lunch break, you know, because, you know, he's a believer, he'll understand. Grace, bro. Do I get grace or not, you know? And or spend your whole time witnessing where you stop working. You know, I've met guys that, you know, their mouth starts and their hands stop. And I think we should be capable of walking and chewing bubble gum at the same time. You know, that we can work and we can talk. We can still do our primary job and still witness of Jesus and talk about him and incorporate him in the conversation. But it doesn't mean that just because you start talking about the Bible or the Lord that everything else stops, because we're called to be good stewards. We're called to be good employees. I've had so many Christian, you know, pastors and leaders and different people tell me, you cannot witness at work. That is not true. You can witness with words. You can witness with your action. But that neither of those things should interfere with the work you're supposed to do, because we're hired to do a job, and we should be a good, faithful witness in that. And so I think, you know, I think we can do both. But be an encouragement to our employer. If they're a Christian, you know, then demonstrate Christian values by working hard and encouraging them in their faith, praying for them, all those different kinds of things. You know, do your job, be on time, be reliable. You know, be a good witness. Sometimes, you know, sadly, I've talked to some employers that say, oh, man, these Christians, man, they're the worst employees. You know, they always think you're supposed to give them, you know, grace for everything, and there's no accountability and all kinds of stuff. And it's like, you know, both my sons kind of testified, you know, working at Starbucks, that Christians are like the crummiest customers they've got. They walk in and they're mean and all this kind of stuff. Well, you know, I wish people had like a badge, like a Christian badge, so you could just rip it off. Okay, stop saying you're a Christian. I've actually told guys to stop telling people that you're a Christian. If you're going to act like it, say it. But if you're not going to act like it, then stop telling people. And that's kind of what Paul is getting to here. Now, in verse 3, he switches gears in a kind of dramatic way. You know, we're going to go through this, and I think there's practical things that for each of us as we go through this. But I just want to give you the parameters a little bit. From verses 3 through 10, Paul is really addressing false teachers. I mean, these are things for us to avoid. But he's addressing false teachers. I think he's addressing the false prosperity doctrines that we've probably heard about in different places. And so keep that in mind as we go through it, because he starts off, if anyone teaches otherwise, I mean, he's taught the right thing, be a good witness, be a good worker. If anyone teaches otherwise and does not consent to wholesome words, even the words of our Lord Jesus Christ, and to the doctrine which accords with godliness, he goes on to say he's proud. And he'll just run down the flagpole in a second. But this is a warning. This is an admonition. If anyone teaches otherwise, and there are some that are simply contrary to good teaching, we need to watch out for them, and as he'll tell us a little bit later on, and then we need to avoid them. You know, one of the first marks of a false teacher is that they refuse to adhere to sound biblical doctrine and godly instruction because they think they know better. And they've got a slant on it or a twist or something. And we've got to continue just to compare everything to God's word. You know, Isaiah warns us in Isaiah chapter 8, verse 20. Speaking of false teachers, he says, to the law and to the testimony. That's the comparison. When you're suspicious or when you're not suspicious, you know, be like a brain and compare it to Scripture. To the law and to the testimony, because that's the gauge. And then he says, if they do not speak according to this word, it's because there's no light in them. Uh-oh. If there's no light in them, that means there's no Holy Spirit. That means there's no Jesus. That means they're bad guys. Okay, be careful. It says, describing them not consenting to good teaching, to wholesome words, even the words of our Lord. Now, I reverse this a little bit. The bad guys aren't listening to good teaching, good doctrine, or the words of Jesus, but you notice in that sentence that he says the words of Jesus are good. Wholesome doctrine. The Bible's good. I challenge any of you, just get your Bible up, play, you know, Bible roulette, hit a page, and find me a scripture that isn't good. It's not going to happen. It's all good. It's all good. You know, Proverbs chapter 30, verse 5, every word of God is pure. Every word of God is holy. Every word of God is worthy of just, you know, our attention, our focus. But he talks about the doctrine which accords, you know, the contrary to the doctrine which accords with godliness. You know, the doctrines, the teachings which accord with godliness, the fruit of it. Does the teaching lead you to godliness, or does the teaching lead you to godlessness? You know, the fruit of it. And so we need to examine that fruit. This really comes back to love and the fruit of the Spirit. You know, the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, long-suffering. In Galatians 5:22, we did that earlier. But again, that's the fruit. And you know, what I found, the fruit of God's word in my life at times, there's been times when I'm like anybody else. Something hits me wrong and I'm in a foul mood, or I'm cranky, or I'm, you know, angry about, you know, stupid, nonsensical things. Anybody else besides me ever get mad about something that doesn't even exist? You know? But what I found is that when I bury my heart and sometimes my anger in God's word, and I just start reading it, or I start thinking about it, or I listen to a Bible study and I start to pray and seek his face, I'm blown away by how it changes the fruit that comes out of me. I'm blown away by the days when I have, you know, just awesome devotions with the Lord, and I connect, you know, and it's like, oh, Lord, thank you so much, you know. And you almost kind of hate to stop doing your devotions, but you got to go do other stuff, and so you do. And the day maybe falls apart in front of you, but it's like, oh, isn't that cute? Oh, isn't that something, you know. And what comes out of my mouth is way different if I get the word in there first. The fruit of it. And we all know the fruit of not doing it, too. The days when you're going to get up late, don't have time, blah, 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 blah. You know, and the day falls apart, and it's just like, oh, man, you know, it's like, can I go to bed now? It's noon. You know, can I start over? But the fruit of not doing it is just as evident at times. And so look at verse 4. It says, continuing this description of a false teacher, he says he is proud, knowing nothing, but is obsessed with disputes and arguments over words, from which come envy and strife, reviling, evil suspicions, and goes on to useless wranglings and stuff in verse 5. But this is the second indicator of a false teacher, and that is that they're usually proud. You see that pridefulness. And if they don't consent to wholesome words and good teaching, it's because they're proud and know nothing. And these aren't my words, quoting Paul, and like to argue. A verse that I keep coming across, and I think the Lord's trying to tell me something, but in Proverbs chapter 12, verse 1, whoever loves instruction loves knowledge, but he who hates correction is stupid. That's a direct quote, by the way. King James says brutish, but I prefer New King James in this instance because I can understand that, you know. The biggest hindrance or impediment to gaining wisdom is the false assumption that you already have it. You ever try to teach somebody that's unteachable? Why are they unteachable? Because they think they already know it. And it's when you have, you know, one of the things that we have to learn as a child all the way through our adulthood is that we need to learn how to learn. We need to, and to keep that in our mindset. You know, I know certain things right now. Like, you know, right now I just know that Jesus is God. I know that Jesus died on the cross for my sins. And I know that he rose again. So I'm not going to let anyone teach me something different on that accord. There's certain things that are set. But there are some things, and we could talk about different things in the Bible that are, maybe are more negotiable, more debatable, things like that. And I don't always, I mean, I've got my opinions, but there's some things I'm dogmatic about, like the deity of Jesus. There's other things I hold a little lighter sometimes, and I'm willing to, well, you know, I kind of lean this way. This is what I think, what I believe. And I'm not going to dog somebody else because they got a different opinion. I might consider it. And I have switched my view on things over the years, from what I learned early on to what I've, you know, matured into, I hope, or learned more about in the Word, different things. We have to be teachable. And part of that is not being, quote, unquote, prideful. So, but that's a marker. That's an indicator of a false teacher. And then when you look at the list presented here of that proud person, they like disputes. They like arguing. They're always involved in strife and evil suspicions and reviling and all that kind of stuff, you know. And it's like, that's just the stuff you want to avoid. But this is very similar to another list that we have in the Bible. In Galatians chapter 5, verse 19, it describes the works of the flesh. It's funny, I misspoke this many times. I thought about the fruit of the Spirit, so I went to the fruit of the flesh. It's not the fruit of the flesh, it's the work of the flesh. That's another Bible study. But anyway, Galatians 5, 19 through 21. Now the works of the flesh are evident, which are adultery, fornication, uncleanness, lewdness, idolatry, sorcery, hatred, contentions, jealousies, outbursts of wrath, selfish ambitions or strife, dissensions, heresies, envy, murders, drunkenness, revelries, and the like, of which I tell you beforehand, just as I told you in time past, that those who practice such things will not inherit the kingdom of God. But you can look at the list that Paul lists there in verse 4, and you can just kind of check them off out of the works of the flesh. Again, these are things that we want to avoid. In verse 5, goes on with that list, useless wranglings. I've been wrestled with some of those before, of men of corrupt minds and destitute of the truth, who suppose that godliness is a means of gain. From such withdraw yourself. So it continues from verse 4, useless or perverse arguments. Not only are they proud, as Paul described, but they're, it says here, of corrupt minds, destitute of the truth. Now, what's a corrupt mind? I think of corruption. Like when a body dies, it goes to corruption. It decomposes, it decays. I think about spoiled fruit. You know, fruit has different seasons. It buds on the bush or tree or whatever it does, you know, and then it matures, and then it ripens, and if you pluck it and eat it at that point, it's really good. But if you pluck it after it's ripened and you set it on the table for a while, it spoils, it decays, it decomposes. It's no longer good for anything but throwing at people. And not even good for that, really, but I'm glad you guys don't have any rotten fruit now. But anyway, but it says that they have corrupt minds. And what's it say there regarding the truth? It says that they're destitute, if you will, of the truth. It's like, wow. Destitute of the truth. That means poor. Truth poor. Now, as you open up your Bible, you're truth rich. Rich. Really rich. It's the gift that keeps on giving. You know, wait, there's more. And there always is. But, you know, Jesus said in John chapter 8, verses 31 and 32, he said, if you abide in my word, you're my disciples indeed, and you shall know the truth, and the truth will make you free. Now, I like that it's an indicator of a disciple, one who continues in the word of God, abides there. But he says the truth will make you free. And I say free from sin and death for sure, but also free from the lies, free from the corruptions that are out there. Otherwise, our minds are dead and decaying, corrupt, and that which comes out of us is pretty much the same, corrupt as well. We need to remove those corrupting influences, and you need to go through your own life. I could stand up here and give you a list of holy things and unholy things, you know, do these things, don't do those other things. Paul will go through some of that list. I don't need to give you that list. But there are corrupting influences in all of our lives. It's just kind of, we live in a corrupt world. And I think we need to go through at times and say, you know what, what's influencing me? And then control those things. The eye gate, the ear gate, the heart gate, different things. And so, but he says, if you continue my word, you should be my disciples indeed, and you'll know the truth. The truth will make you free. And so the third indicator that's listed partway through this verse, the third indicator of a false teacher, a bad teacher, if you will, is what's their motivation? What's the motivation there? In verse 5, it says that godliness is a means of gain. From such, withdraw yourself. Now, I say, because it's like, it's disgusting to me. I can give you a list of TV evangelists that, you know, household names, that if there wasn't money in peddling religion, you'd never hear their name. But because they can make their millions and do all that kind of stuff, that's their motivation. It's not because they're trying to help people. It's not because they're trying to spread the word of God, you know, the more noble types of motivations. Their motivation is money. And I remember watching one guy on TV years ago. He sat down and had a hissy fit. If you don't start sending money, and I'm going to stop. And then, oh, no. And then all the money kind of flooding in, you know. It's insane. But that's the motivator for a lot of false teachers, is the finances. And so, you know, that's the wrong motive. Peter tells us in 1 Peter chapter 5, verse 2, he said, shepherd the flock of God which is among you, serving as overseers, not by compulsion, but willingly, not for dishonest gain, but eagerly, nor as being lords over those entrusted to you, but being examples to the flock. And, you know, and the same men that I'm talking about, and women, they're not good examples. You look at their life and go, man, you know, if you did that, I would rebuke you. If I did that, I would expect you to rebuke me, okay? And so we're held to a much higher standard. But he says, withdraw from those kinds of people. Withdraw from these bad influences. Get away from them, these corrupting influences. And I've had some, you know, hard conversations with people at time, and I've told different people, said, you know, I love you in the Lord, But I just have to tell you straight to your face, you're a corrupting influence. And it's like, but you know what? And there's been times I've asked people to leave our fellowship because they're corrupting influences. And it's not an easy thing to do. I don't relish that. But there have been times when I've had to do that to protect the flock. And I will do that because that's what God's called me to do. But sometimes we need to do it for ourselves. Sometimes we need to recognize those things and, you know, and do that. In Proverbs chapter 12, verse 26, the righteous should choose his friends carefully, for the way of the wicked leads them astray. More often than not, in an unequal yoke kind of relationship, the bad influence seems to influence the righteous person more. And I fully believe in evangelizing. I fully believe in being a good witness and trying to help people see the light. But there comes a point in time when we have to decide who we love more, Jesus or that person. And we have to sometimes entrust that person into his care, knowing that, you know, we just can't do anymore. We're told in 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verse 33, be not deceived, evil company corrupts good habits. And that's a sad truth, but it's true. In verse 6, now godliness with contentment is great gain. That is so true. When you're content in Jesus, you find yourself content in so many things. It's kind of funny. I remember having an iPhone 4S for a long time. In fact, I'd even pull it out every night and go, hey, is that an iPhone 4S? Shouldn't that be like in a museum? But I come from a day when, I remember the first cell phones, you had a car battery, then you had like a big gold cord and a regular phone receiver, like the old style phone receivers. And this thing weighed like 80 pounds. These guys walked around like they were so cool, you know? And then I remember when they came out with smartphones versus flip phones, you know? And then, you know, the Blackberries, you guys remember those things with 1,000 buttons on them? You know, and they get to an iPhone 4S, which is a technological marvel. People look at you like, man, that's like last week. What are you talking? You know, and people had to get the next one, the next one, the next one. And I kind of say that tongue in cheek because we're a techno society. But some people are never satisfied. I mean, if something new comes up, they got to have it. And I know guys that are very content still on their flip phone. Like, and God bless you, you know. But the bottom line is, whatever it is, whether it's a car or a phone or, you know, wealth or whatever, you're never going to be content until you're content in Christ. Then once you are, you may make those decisions and you may upgrade, you may do stuff, but it's not in a lustful, weird kind of way. It's just like, oh, it's functional or whatever, you know. And people do that, and it's okay. But Paul was one of those guys that he was able to be content in a lot of different situations, and he was in a lot of different situations. In Philippians chapter 4, verse 11, he says, not that I speak in regard to need, for I have learned whatever state I'm in to be content. And he goes on to describe that he'd been without food, without clothes, you know, without support, different things. And he was still a happy camper because his joy was in the Lord, not in the stuff. The writer of Hebrews tells us in Hebrews chapter 13, verse 5, let your conduct be without covetousness, be content with such things as you have. For he himself has said, I will never leave you nor forsake you. It's the idea that God's never going to leave us or forsake us. We're content in him. We're secure in him. So we can be content. We don't have to, you know, worry about the next thing or the next thing. Our contentment is only found in Christ. And when you're content in Christ, you'll find yourself pretty much content in everything else. But when you're not content in Christ, then you won't find contentment seemingly in anything. And, you know, you see people all the time that are always, you know, trading cars in and back, and, you know, back in, you know, their lives are all kind of was swirling around different things. And because they're searching for contentment in all the wrong places, like the old cowboy song. Chuck Smith's dad, I read this in Chuck's commentary, but Chuck Smith's dad had this quote on his desk, a little plaque with a saying on it. And it says, Lord, don't bless me beyond my capacity to love you. Don't you like that? You think about Jewish history. You know, you go back to the book of Judges when everyone did what was right in their own eyes. When did they do good? Well, when they were oppressed and they were starving and, you know, afflicted, they were crying out to God and then he would bless them, they'd walk in his ways. Then what happened? When he blessed them and they got fat and sassy and content and, you know, kind of confident, they kind of forgot who God was. went back to their idolatry ways, you know, and so being in that balanced kind of place, well, Lord, you know, like the guy in Proverbs says, you know, don't give me too much where I forget who you are, but don't starve me so I blaspheme you by stealing. And it's the idea that there has to be a balance in that. Job kind of echoed the same thing. In verse 7, he says, we brought nothing into this world, and it's certain we'll carry nothing out. You know, Job tells us in Job 121, naked I came from my mother's womb, and naked I shall return. The Lord gave, and the Lord has taken away. Blessed be the name of the Lord. And so, again, Job kind of felt the same way. You know, I think about our Lord. Can you think about what he owned? He didn't have a place to lay his head. And, you know, he didn't have, you know, anything pretty, you know, cool that I know of, you know, that you just describe any physical possessions. I mean, he had the clothes on his back, and he had the Bible memorized, so he didn't carry one of those, you know. But even when you think about when he died, what little he had, the clothes on his back were taken away from him. It's like, wow. I'm not pushing an ascetic lifestyle. I don't think Paul is. I think it's more having a right perspective on possessions and things and stuff. That those are things and stuff. We use them, you know, and then like tools or whatever, but God can take it out of your hand. He can put it in your hand. I remember when I first became when I entered into a real faith walk with the Lord, I had multiple hobbies and things I liked doing, backpacking and camping, and liked shooting guns, and I liked, you know, construction work, and three or four of the things, like, you know. And all of a sudden, all that kind of stuff stopped for a season where I didn't do anything but study my Bible. I was just locked. My wife was a Bible widow, you know, and I locked myself in the garage. Don't disturb me. I'm reading my Bible, you know. And after a couple of years, I came out. God told me to. And but I'd given up. I hadn't actually touched my tools in like a year, except what I just really had to do at the house or something like that. And I remember being at church one day, and I became aware of this widow woman that, you know, she's kind of floundering, and just a gate at her house. It was frustrating her. This simple wooden gate was broken, wasn't functioning, and for her it was distressing. And I just remember hearing about that and going, hey, you know, so I grabbed my wife and grabbed some tools. We went over there, and we were going to fix this gate, right? And I served the Lord. I had my hands in front of me as I'm working on this gate in front of me, and the Lord spoke to me so clearly. You set those tools down for me, but I put them back in your hands for my glory. It's like, oh, Lord, you know, and I love that kind of stuff. But it can't be about the tools. I remember being a young man, young married man, so poor. I mean, I didn't have two nickels rubbed together, but I'd walk through the Sears Craftsman section and just drool at everything. Oh, wow, you know, and lust after all the tools. And now I got tools, but tools don't have me. Before, they had me. And so that's what he's talking about, that we look at life differently. We're content in him. In verse 8, it says, in having food and clothing, with these, we should be content. You know, I can't complain. I haven't gotten so skinny you can see any of my ribs or anything. You know, there's lots of people on this earth that don't have food and clothing. We should be very, very grateful and content. And considering how God has blessed us and kept us, we should be very grateful. Earlier I made mention of Proverbs chapter 30, verses 7, 8, 9. It says, two things I request of you, deprive me not before I die. Remove falsehood and lies far from me. Give me neither poverty nor riches. Feed me with the food allotted to me, lest I be full and deny you and say, who is the Lord? Or lest I be poor and steal and profane the name of my God. You know, again, God has done so much for us. And in verse 9, he goes on, he says, you know, but those who desire to be rich fall into temptation and a snare, into many foolish and harmful lusts, which drown men in destruction and perdition. Desiring to be rich is a snare, and I think for a Christian especially, it's out of order. It's the wrong priority. You know, it's the opposite of being content, and it's really the wrong focus. And what it comes down to, I think, is its covetousness. Bad, bad, bad. You know, Jesus told his disciples and tells us in Matthew chapter 6, verse 24, no one can serve two masters, for either he will hate the one and love the other, or else he'll be loyal to the one and despise the other. You cannot serve God and mammon. We kind of, in a certain sense, have to figure out who our God is and worship him. Okay? You know, it's a matter of focus. It's a matter of priorities in a certain sense. Jesus told us in Matthew 6:33, he said, "Seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, then all these things will be added unto you." And when you make him the first priority in your life, the first thing that you focus on, the other things, whatever they are, they'll be added to you, the things that you need. And quite honestly, a lot of things that you desire, that'll be added to you when you've got your priorities straight. We've got to keep our priorities straight. I love what David wrote in Psalm 37, verse 4. He says, "Delight yourself also in the Lord, and he'll give you the desires of your heart." But, and I love this, that when you delight yourself in the Lord and he becomes the desire of your heart, all of a sudden your heart becomes more like his heart and you desire the things that he desires. And so when he gives you the desires of your heart, he's really giving you more of himself and more of the things that he loves. And it's this kind of snowballing kind of cool thing. And you're sitting there with a smile on your face and you go, "I love life." And people look at you like you're nuts. It's like, yeah, okay. Nuts for Jesus. Like, yeah, but delight yourself in the Lord. Now, the reasoning behind this, in part, is expressed in verse 10. "For the love of money is the root of all kinds of evil, for which some have strayed from the faith and their greediness and pierced themselves through with many sorrows." The love of money. It's not money. It's the love of money is the root of all kinds of evil, not so much money itself. We need to be careful. You know, I mean, we need money in a certain sense. We use money. But we got to make sure that it doesn't keep us and use us. Jesus said in Matthew 6, verse 19, "Do not lay up for yourselves treasures on earth where moth and rust destroy, where thieves break in and steal. But lay up for yourselves treasures in heaven where neither moth nor rust destroys and where thieves do not break in and steal. For where your treasure is, there your heart will be also." And so we got to keep our heart, you know, keep our focus on him. The love of money can easily become idolatry. And this is something that God abhors and speaks very strongly against. Remember the first commandment in Exodus chapter 20, verses 2 and 3. "I am the Lord your God. You shall have no other gods before me." Our God is a jealous God. And if, in a, as a believing Christian, if money's going to get in the way, guess what? He can remove the money pretty easy. You know, if that becomes an issue, and I think that all of us would give God this sway. "Lord, if something's going to cause me to stumble, then remove whatever that something is. Because I want to have a good relationship with you. That's more important than anything else we can do." And so this lust and pursuit has led many, as the previous verse kind of stated, into temptation. And a snare, it's a trap. You guys ever watch one of them old, you know, cheesy horror flicks? And the person just has to go down in that spooky basement. And you're going, "Don't do it, don't do it." Or they go, "I'm going to go into those dark woods." You know, and they walk off into the woods. You go, "Don't do it." And you watch them and you go, "Don't, no." And you just, "No." And then, you know, they get in there and sure, the creep, the bad guy, whatever, the monster comes out. And, you know, ah. But that's what the lust of money and the desire for riches is all about. And sometimes, not us because we're too involved, but sometimes other people watching us, it's like, "Oh no," and it's like a horror movie. "Don't do it, don't do it." But you see him just like let off, you know, "No, no, no." And you want to pull him back. But something is in our heart like that, we can't necessarily pull him back. That's the work of God. And I pray God will do that. But sometimes people have to get burned. You got to burn them and learn them, you know. An old internal affairs expression. I got fringes and burns and singes, and I learned. But the bottom line is that we've got to be careful, because this covetousness, this idolatry, have led so many astray. They've pierced them through, as this verse indicates, with many sorrows. And it's a hard thing. In verse 11, "But you, O man of God," see the first word there, "but." That's a contrasting word. He's been talking about false teachers. He's been talking about the prosperity doctrine people, all that kind of stuff. But contrast, "you, O man of God." Oh, and I love that. Wouldn't you like for Paul to call you, "O man of God, O woman of God"? Like, man, Timothy's in a good place. He says, "Flee these things and pursue righteousness, godliness, faith, love, patience, gentleness. And so the man of God, flee evil things. When he says man of God, then he says flee evil things. He says man of God, stay a man of God. Keep being a man of God. And the way you're going to be a man of God, and what a man of God does, is he flees these things. Don't hang out with it. Don't play with it. Don't coddle it. Don't think that you can handle it, because you can't. If he'd said kill it, we would kill it. But this time he says flee from it. There's a time to put them up. All right, let's go. And there's a time to hit the road, Jack. You know, and Paul is saying there's some things that you're not equipped necessarily to fight. And so these are the things that you're gonna flee from that. You know, Proverbs chapter 3, verse 7. Be not wise in your own eyes. Fear the Lord and depart from evil. In the next letter that Paul writes to Timothy, 2 Timothy chapter 2, verse 22, flee also youthful lust, but pursue righteousness, faith, love, and so on. But there's a time to pack it up. Remember Joseph with Potiphar's wife? He didn't stick around to figure out how that was going to end if he just hung around. He picked him up and put him down and jammed out of that house. Better to be in prison than to be in hell. You know, we know that the weapons of our warfare are not carnal. They're mighty in God. But there's a time that we're called to fight, for sure. There's a time that we're called to flee. God help us to know the difference. God help us to hear his voice. David asked all the time, do I go after these guys or not? Sometimes he said yes. Sometimes he said no, go the other way. So we need to listen for the Lord's voice to tell us. But then after he says flee these things, what's he say next? Pursue. Okay, pursue the good things. You know, pursue righteousness, godliness, faith, love, patience, gentleness. Pursue the good stuff. Run towards them. Godly things. You know, righteousness, godliness, faith, love, patience. Again, this sounds like the fruit of the Spirit, the things of God. Jesus told his disciples in Matthew 5, 6, blessed are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness, for they shall be filled. And I think I say this only every time I quote this verse. If you're in that place, and you know if you are or not, where you do hunger and thirst for righteousness, that's awesome. But you know just as well, if you're on the opposite side of that, that you don't really pursue after. I mean, it's not really your heart's desire. It's not really your thing. You know, I've heard people say, well, I'm a Christian, but not like you. Well, that's a cop-out. But if you know that you're in that place, it's okay to pray, God, give me a hunger and thirst for your righteousness. God, put a desire in my heart. Help me to be that man of God. Help me to be that woman of God. You know, give me a heart for you, Lord. You pray that kind of prayer, hang on to your seat, man, because God's going to give it to you in ways that you don't even know. But I've been there. I've been there many times. Lord, would you give me a desire for your word? Would you give me a desire for fellowship and to commune with you? And he does that. We need it. The prophet Jeremiah tells us in Jeremiah 29:13, and you will seek me and find me when you search for me with all your heart. And sometimes the roadblock in those things, because you know, I've heard people tell me, well, Pastor Mike, you know, I don't like this, or you know, God's not talking to me, and this and the other thing. And sometimes it's as simple as admitting to God. I mean, you know that that's where you're at, and you know you're kind of like hanging in nowhere, and you're not feeling anything, you're not hearing anything, boop, 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 you know, radio silence or whatever. And it's okay to say, when you finally come to that conclusion, why? Because I've talked to people that say, well, I don't hear from God anymore. One of my first questions is, do you want to hear from him? And I've had people say, well, not really. Or what was the last thing he told you? Did you do that? Because if you told him one thing, why should you tell you the second thing if you haven't done the first thing? There are different things, but when he brings it to that place of truth, place of honesty, that's the first step. And it's amazing how God will honor that. In verse 12, he says, fight the good fight of faith, lay hold on eternal life to which you were also called, and have confessed the good confession in the presence of many witnesses. One of the things that I've done when I've gone to speak at conferences and stuff, which I don't do a lot of anymore lately anyway, but when I've been invited to speak somewhere, I usually introduce myself. Hi, my name is Mike. I'm the pastor at Calvary Chapel. But I give you my bio, but the only thing you really need to know about me is I love Jesus. Jesus is my Lord and Savior. And that's how I like to start things off, because I just want to say, that's the most important thing about me. And so I love Jesus, and that's my way of confessing to more people if I can. And I think that's what Paul is talking about related to Timothy, that he gave a good confession. So he tells him, fight the fight of faith. Well, you know, when you think about fighting involves a struggle. It's a war between, honestly, the flesh and the spirit. And if you will, for just a second, turn to the left to Romans chapter 7. Romans chapter 7. We're going to look at verses 18 through 24. Because I'll be honest with you, when I started studying through this, my first thought was a spiritual warfare. A lot of us have been going through spiritual warfare lately. There's a lot of things going on, you know, and we can all kind of attest to that. My daughter's shaking her head. Oh, no, everything's perfect. But the warfare that I fight the most is me. The war that I fight the most is my flesh. I can write it off to spiritual warfare, and that would be true in a lot of instances. But I fight my own flesh all the time. And I'd like to, I won't tell you what the record is, but it's not so good. But in Romans chapter 7, verse 18, it says, for I know that in me, that is in my flesh, nothing good dwells. For to will is present with me, but how to perform what is good, I do not find. For the good that I will do, I do not do. But the evil I will not to do, that I practice. Now, if I do what I will not to do, it is no longer I who does it, but sin that dwells in me. I find then a law that evil is present with me, the one who wills to do good. For I delight in the law of God according to the inward man, but I see another law in my members warring against the law of my mind and bringing me into captivity to the law of sin, which is in my members. O wretched man that I am, who will deliver me from this body of death? And I can answer that question. Jesus. The same one that would deliver him would deliver us. And we fight that war with the flesh all the time. And sometimes, you know, we do well in public. Sometimes we don't. There's witnesses. But the bottom line is, it's a humiliating thing to realize how much we need him to give us that victory. Now, turn back to where are we at? Timothy. And Paul tells us that in Ephesians 6:12, for we wrestle not against flesh and blood, but against principalities, against powers, against the rulers of the darkness of this age, against spiritual hosts of wickedness in the heavenly places. You know, there is that element of spiritual warfare. I can't completely discount. It's all my flesh. It's partly the enemy, but it's, you know, demonic stuff, oppression, but it's also my flesh. I can't take myself out of the equation. So we got to be ready to life for all kinds of stuff. But we're told in 2 Corinthians chapter 10, verse 4, that the weapons of our warfare are not carnal, but mighty in God for pulling down strongholds. So we've been equipped. And then in James chapter 4, verse 7, therefore submit to God, resist the devil, and he'll flee from you. If we'll just fight back a little bit, he'll flee from us. If we resist the enemy, he will flee from us. And the best way to resist is, Lord, then you can fill in the blank. Lord, help me. In verses 13 and 14, I urge you in the sight of God who gives life to all things and be before Christ Jesus, who witnessed the good confession before Pontius Pilate, that you keep this commandment without spot, blameless until our Lord Jesus is appearing, Lord Jesus Christ appearing. So first off, he says, I charge you. In the New King James, it's I urge you. In the King James, it's I charge you, but it's the same basic word. Again, not forgetting that Paul is Timothy's mentor and teacher, He's using some pretty strong language. And if you go back through this letter, you'll see that he's used some strong language all the way through it. 1 Timothy 1:18, I charge you, this charge I commit to you, that you wage a good warfare. 1 Timothy chapter 4, verse 11, these things command and teach. 1 Timothy chapter 5, verse 21, I charge you before God and the Lord Jesus Christ. He's using some pretty strong language here. I don't see a lot of wiggle room. And all of this, as he says here, in the sight of God. You know, before Jesus, who lived and witnessed a good confession before Pontius Pilate, you know, Jesus didn't deny himself before Pilate. And the exhortation here is to keep the charge, or to keep this commandment. Now, I kind of had a hard time with this, because what is, quote unquote, this commandment? As I go through this chapter, then I go back through the whole book, there's a whole bunch of commandments, a bunch of different things that we're called to. And I think it's flee wicked things, pursue after righteousness, fight the good fight, you know, keep the faith, brother. All those things. But what I do is I kind of lump it all together, and in my mind, I kind of generalize it a little bit. And I think about 1 John chapter 5, verse 3, and there's other verses we could go to, but it says the same thing. For this is the love of God, that we keep his commandments. And his commandments aren't burdensome. You know, it's not work when you love the one you're working for. It's a joy. And to keep his commandments shouldn't be hard for a Christian to do, because he's given us of his Holy Spirit to do it. But why does he use such, now, tongue-in-cheek here, charged language? Why is he so strong in the warning, the exhortation, the charge here? The answer here is in the verse, until our Lord Jesus Christ's appearing. He senses urgency. He thinks the Lord Jesus is coming back soon. If Paul the Apostle, writing this letter, thought that Jesus was coming back pretty soon, then how soon are we now? You follow me? I mean, to me, this is amazing stuff. If he was close then where do you think he is now? And we've talked a lot lately, because of the coronavirus and all the things that have happened, different things about birth pangs, which we're seeing on a daily basis. Paul's next letter to Timothy will paint a similar picture. You know, in the last days, perilous times are come. They're here, folks. We're seeing it. And Jesus told his disciples in John 16:21, a woman, when she's in labor, has sorrow because her hour has come. But as soon as she's given birth to the child, she no longer remembers the anguish for joy that a man was born into the world. And the idea is that we're seeing the birth pangs, and it's a pain. I don't like seeing the corruption and the lies and the evilness and all the bad things that are happening in the world. You look at that and go, drive you nuts. If I didn't have hope of Jesus Christ, I would be nuts. But you see the birth pangs, you see all the stuff, and we're going through it. But the reason we can go through it is because the prize at the end is him, being with him in heaven forever. And knowing that the birth pangs and all the things are getting more forceful, the gaps are smaller, the contractions are happening faster and faster, that means the rapture is right around the corner. That means we're almost there, folks. Could happen at any time. 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, verse 17. Then we who are alive and remain shall be caught up together with them in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air, and thus we shall always be with the Lord. Bring it, Lord, bring it. Verse 15. Which he will manifest in his own time. He was blessed, the only potentate, the King of kings and Lord of lords, who alone has immortality, dwelling in unapproachable light, whom no man has seen or can see, to whom be honor and everlasting power. Amen. We could go through this section of Scripture and make this a whole Bible study all by itself, just the thinking about the glory of God. But the thing is that as Paul is thinking about all these things, he gets kind of wrapped up in the glory of God. And you see this doxology of praise as he begins to worship God. And, you know, Jesus told his disciples in John 4:24, God is spirit, and those who worship him must worship him in spirit and truth. And that's what we see Paul doing. Then in verse 17, again, command those who are rich in this present age not to be haughty nor to trust in uncertain riches, but in the living God who gives us richly all things to enjoy. And so the admonition here is to command those who are well off or whatever, don't be prideful. Don't put your trust in your riches, your uncertain riches. I know more men that were millionaires than they were like poor. You know, I listen to Chuck Missler's testimony. He made a fortune, he lost a fortune. He made a fortune, he lost a fortune. He made a fortune, he lost a fortune. Now he's home with the Lord. But I mean, there's guys like that. I mean, you look at President Trump, you look at his history. There were times when he filed for bankruptcy. Whoa, how could a billionaire do that? I don't know. All I know is that when I have money, then I don't have money. Then I have money, then I don't have money. I can relate to this. But don't trust in your riches. Solomon tells us in Proverbs 23, verse 5, will you set your eyes on that which is not? For riches certainly make themselves wings. They fly away like an eagle towards heaven. I've seen that. See, it says, command those who are rich in this present age, those who have been blessed and given a stewardship, don't forget where it came from. James 1:17, for every good gift and every perfect gift is from above and comes down from the Father of lights, with whom there's no variation or shadow of turning. So it's kind of fascinating in a way. Paul starts off instructing what? Servants, bondservants, those under the yoke, slaves. Now he instructs the rich and the wealthy. You know, he's got something for everybody. And God, the last part of that, God has given us all things to enjoy, like nature itself, you know, and fellowship and people and all kinds of cool stuff. But, you know, we're told in 2 Corinthians chapter 8, verse 9, for you know the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, that though he was rich, yet for your sakes he became poor, that you through his poverty might become rich. Now, the caveat here is knowing what real riches is. Because Paul said, you know, the stuff that I've got in life, I count it as rubbish. Dung for the knowledge of Christ. True riches are having fellowship with him. What would a man give? Jesus asks. You don't have enough, I'll tell you that. So true riches are having that relationship with him. In verses 18 and 19, let them do good, speaking of these rich people, that they may be rich in good works, ready to give, willing to share, storing up for themselves a good foundation for the time to come, that they may lay hold on eternal life. Them, those who God has blessed that way, let them use their wealth for the glory of God and ministering to his people. You know, Jesus tells us in Matthew chapter 19, verse 23, verily, verily, I say unto you, it's hard for a rich man to enter the kingdom of heaven. Again, I say to you, it's easier for a camel to go through the eye of a needle than for a rich man to enter the kingdom of God. Why is that? Because focus. You know, I know rich men that are God's enabled to be rich and keep him straight up in their mind, and God's blessed them that way. I'm not that way. He's kept me, I mean, I live well. But God's not entrusting me with millions or billions. It would wreck me. I'm like the guy that, I'm like Solomon, he prayed, give me enough food for today, you know, and that I won't steal and blaspheme you. Don't make me so wealthy that I forget who you are. We need to be in that needy kind of place, and that's a good place to be. And so, you know, but God has blessed some to do that. Have that right balance. You know, have an open hand. You know, when your hand is open, God can put in your hand, he can take out of your hand. When your fist is closed around your riches, you can't give it away, and God can't seemingly put more in. So you want to do it with an open hand. And it comes down to the old adage that, you know, you can't take it with you, but you can certainly send it ahead. So give till it hurts, that's all I can tell you. verse 20, O Timothy, guard what was committed to your trust. Avoid the profane and idle babblings and contradictions of what is falsely called knowledge. So guard, be vigilant, be aware, be on the lookout, you know, be watchful. Peter tells us in 1 Peter chapter 5, verse 8, be sober, be vigilant, because your adversary the devil walks about like a roaring lion seeking whom he may devour. We need to be on the lookout. It's kind of funny, and I'm not sure if it's just, not all men are like this, but I know a lot of men are. Some women are. Cops are. That you walk in a room and you just pan the room. You go places and you're looking around, you know. But I watch other people just do-do-do-do-do, and they bump into people. They don't walk around, all kind of stuff, and they don't have a clue, you know. And I'm not knocking that so bad because, I mean, it's nice to have a life like that where you don't have those kinds of cares sometimes. But we are called to be looking around knowing that the enemy's trying to sneak up on us. You know, when I scare one of my kids, every now and then they'll walk out in a place or this or that, and I see that they're just totally unaware. And it just thrills me to death, perversely, to sneak up on them and scare them and make them jump or scream or fall down or something. But every time I do that, I know they're out to get me. And so then I'm looking around, I'm looking over my shoulder, and make sure look at the seat before I sit down, all the different things that could happen, you know, because I go, payback's coming. But we should know that the enemy's after us, and we need to be on the lookout all the time. And that's, so he tells Timothy, guard that. Now when he describes of what is falsely called knowledge. I make an assumption in a way that he's probably talking about Gnosticism, the Gnostic heresies that started then, and I think that's reasonable. But I would also just throw in there, and it could be a lot of things, but I would throw in there evolution. How many people, when it says by professing it, some have strayed concerning the faith, how many people has Darwinian evolutionary theories stumbled? It's caused good Christians to try and, well, let's explain this, and so they get into theistic evolution and the gap theory and different foolish things. And yes, the gap theory is foolishness. Another Bible study. But sometimes people get into that kind of stuff and it trips them up. False knowledge. Now, how do you know something? Verse 21, by professing it, some have strayed concerning the faith. Grace be with you, amen. But this knowledge has led many astray. How do you know if something is false knowledge? Straight up, if it contradicts the Bible, it's false. Or if the Bible contradicts it, it's false. If it's consistent with the Bible, then I'd say it's true. But that's the litmus, is God's word. I love Psalm 119, verse 105. It says, thy word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path. God's word will show us the way. God's word is the light that will reveal the truth of the matter, or not. So real fast, I'm going to close, but I want to give you a brief, and I don't always do this, but a brief summary of the chapter, okay? And the first thing is that Paul exhorts us to work hard, to be good witnesses. He tells us to turn away from false teachers. He says to be content. You know, godliness with contentment is great gain. We're told to flee from sin. We're told to pursue after righteousness, pursue what's good. We're told to fight. You know, Christians, we're authorized at this very moment to be attack lambs. Okay, fight the good fight of faith. Then he says, be faithful, be humble, trust God, not your wealth. You know, trust God, not your wealth. And enjoy what God has given you. You know, you got cool stuff, enjoy it. And then finally, employ what God has given you. He didn't always give us our stuff for us. I get the mistaken knowledge, the idea sometimes that, you know, I get a windfall financially or something happens, like, ooh, I start thinking about all the toys I'm going to buy. And sometimes he gives you something so that you can be the vessel that God would use to give it to somebody else or to some other thing. You got to think those things through a little bit. And so, it's a great chapter. It's so instructive in so many ways. And I think that as Paul is exhorting Timothy in all kinds of ways as we go through the previous five chapters, I love this. I love the practical nuts and bolts, meat and potatoes kinds of things. I go, okay, I can figure this out. Now, Lord, would you help me to do it? Would you pour out your spirit upon me and help me to be that man, to be the godly man that Paul describes Timothy as. And so, Lord, help us. Lord, guide us. Gracious Father, once again, we rejoice in you. We thank you, Lord, for your willingness to instruct us and help us to be open and receptive and teachable to your instruction. And we thank you for communicating so clearly from Paul to Timothy and now to us. So lead us as you will, Father, and be glorified in the lives of your servants. We love you, Lord, and we thank you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Well, hey, if you're able, let's stand together and continue to worship.
Presence, thinking of the good things you have done, waiting here patiently just to hear your still small voice again. Holy, righteous, faithful to
Gracious Father, once again, we stand here, Lord, in awe of who you are. We're blown away by your presence and your willingness, Lord, to reach down and touch our lives. And we ask, Lord, that as you reached down and touched our lives, that we would truly be different because of our interaction, our fellowship, our communion with you. Lord, pour out your Spirit upon us, Lord, and help us to be pleasing in your sight. We love you, Lord, and we thank you. We praise you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
The Lord bless thee.
The Lord bless thee.
And keep thee.
And keep thee.
The Lord make his face to shine upon thee. And be gracious unto thee. And be gracious unto thee. The Lord lift up.
The Lord lift up his countenance
upon thee, and give thee peace.
Well, God bless you guys. I pray that our Lord continues to speak to your hearts, to draw you closer and closer to himself, and just he would somehow impress on you how much he loves you. He loves you so much. He loves you so much. And he can't hardly wait to see you. God bless you guys. Hey, I want to ask you, I got a text just before the service started. Regina Mowry, she's a lady that kind of comes out here from Eagle Lake area and comes on Wednesday nights and sometimes on Sundays. But anyway, she's in the hospital tonight. She had some kind of a heart issue. I didn't get the whole thing, some kind of arrhythmia. And you know, it's a bummer because we can't actually go visit with her because, we're locked out. But pray for her. In fact, Father God, we lift up our sister to you. We ask, Lord, that you would comfort her, that you would help her heart to be calm, that you would help her spirit to be calm, that you would minister to her, Lord, as only you can, and that you would use the doctors, the nurses, the techs, everyone involved, Lord, that they would be instruments in your hand as you minister to your daughter. So bless her, Father, and be your comfort, and comfort her husband, Lord. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. If you guys need prayer for any reason, come on up. We'd love to pray with you. Pray you have a good, peaceful night. Get a good night's rest. And we'll see you, Lord willing, on Sunday. That's to see you on the way up.